ओम अज्ञान सिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्री गुरु दीनतारिणो परमानंद माधवं श्री चैतन्येश्वरं। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवी गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे। नमो महाविदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेमा प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्या नामने गौरक्षे नमः। पञ्चतत्त्वात्मकं कृष्णं भक्तरूपस्वरूपकं भक्तावतारं भक्ताख्यं नमामि भक्तशक्तिकं। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत जगदाधा श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंदा। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयं मुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवते उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। सच्चिदानंद रूपाय विश्वोत्पत्यादि हेतवे तापत्राय विनाशाय श्री कृष्णाय वयं नमः। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंद गोप कुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। नमः पंकज नाभाय नमः पंकज मालिने नमः पंकज नेत्राय नमस्ते पंकजांगने। यम ब्रह्म वरुणेन्द्र रुद्र मरुत स्तुवन्ति दिव्यैस्त्वयि वेदे संग पद क्रम उपनिषदे गायन्ति यम सामगा। ध्यानवस्थित तद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यम योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विधुसुरसुरगणा देवायः तस्मै नमः देवायः तस्मै नमः। श्री कृष्णचंद्र भगवान की जय। ग्रंथ श्रीमद् भागवतम की जय। हरे कृष्ण। सो वी हैव बीन डिस्कसिंग श्रीमद् भागवतम 10th कैंट ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम दसम स्कंद। एवरीबॉडी इज फेमिलियर विद श्रीमद् भागवतम होपफुली मोस्ट ऑफ यू आर। कैन वी क्लोज इट लिटिल बिट टू नॉइसी। श्रीमद् भागवतम हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू नो द पुराणस राइट। यू हैव हर्ड अबाउट पुराणस। हाउ मेनी पुराणस आर देयर। हाउ मेनी पुराणस आर देयर। पुराण यस स्कंद पुराण इज वन ऑफ देम। सो हाउ मेनी टोटल पुराण आर देयर।
18
पुराण। You say there are Vedas, Upanishads, Quran, then histories. Histories means Ramayana, Mahabharata. So these are all Vedic literature. So starting from Vedas, the four Vedas, then comes 108 Upanishad, then 18 Puran, then Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita. So out of all those 18 Puran, Srimad Bhagavat Puran is considered as the topmost. It's the ripened fruit of all the Vedic literature. Nigama kalpataror galitam palam shukamukhadamritam. It's spoken by Shukdev Goswami to Shri Parikshit Maharaj. And when he spoke to Parikshit Maharaj, when Parikshit Maharaj got a curse that he will die in 7 days by being bitten by a takshak snake. So that is Srimad Bhagavat Puran. And Bhagavat Puran have 12 cantos, 12 skandha, which talk about various different incarnations of the Lord, various pastimes of the Lord in His various incarnations, His reciprocation with the devotees. And the 10th canto, Dasam Skanda of Srimad Bhagavatam, is description of Lord Krishna's pastime, starting from Lord Krishna's appearance with all His wonderful leelas, His leela in Vrindavan, then His moving to Mathura, His leelas in Dwarika, ultimately His participation in the Kurukshetra war. So all the pastimes of Lord Krishna described, that is 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So we are discussing 10th canto. We discussed the Vrindavan Leela, Krishna killing various demons in Vrindavan. Kansa is sending every day, demons are coming in Vrindavan to attack. In Bhagavatam it described maybe 10, 12, 15 different asuras killed by Krishna. So Shukdev Goswami is speaking only very few of them. So Acharya says every day there are demons coming, attacking. Every day Krishna will kill multiple demons. One at breakfast, one at lunch, one at evening before returning back to home from the forest. Because there is no clock that time. So Krishna, how will you come to know? Now it's breakfast time, one demon killed. Now it's breakfast time. Another demon killed, now it's lunch time. Another demon killed, now it's time to return back to Vrindavan, to home. So every day there are multiple demons attacking, and Shukdev Goswami is describing only few of them, maybe who are considered some very powerful ones, just describing handful of those. So the last day of Krishna's Vrindavan Leela, before he moved to Mathura, last day Krishna killed which demons? We discussed that last time. No, Shankarachara was not last day. Last day, two demons were killed. What were those last day two demons? Keshi. Keshi, who came in the form of? Horse. Good listening. Keshi demon, who came in the form of a horse. And then the another demon which Krishna killed on the last day in his Vrindavan Leela? Vyomasura. Vyomasura, who was like a great magician. He kidnapped all the boys while they were playing hide and seek, while they were playing some other games like sheep. Some cowherd boys were acting as sheep, some were acting as herders, sheep herders, and some were thieves. So they were playing that game, and Vyomasura came as one of the cowherd boys and he stole those all the cowherd boys and put them in one cave. So Krishna killed Vyomasura also and released all those boys. And we discussed what all these demons represent. Right? That's more important to understand. What these demons represent in terms of what anartha they represent. Because for us, just hearing Krishna Leela, yes, that is important. Just hearing the pastimes of Krishna itself is very uplifting, very purifying. But understanding the significance of that Leela, what that Leela represents, what those demons represent, how we should protect ourselves from those demonic mentalities. So that is more important. Right, in this world, everybody is in enjoyment mentality, isn't it? so prominent. We work Monday to Friday, very hard. I don't know if it's hard work or just work. How many of you are really working hard? Anybody who is really, really working hard? 12 hours, 14 hours? Or at least you have to sit in front of your computer, act like you are working. So people, they work, right? Some people work really hard. And as the weekend comes, Saturday, Sunday, what is that? Holiday. Right? Name also has a significance, actually, if we see. People say holiday. Holiday means free time. Saturday, so Friday night they will watch movies till late night, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. By the time they go to bed, it's late night. And then Saturday morning people think, 9, 10, 11 baje aram se soke uthenge, kya jaldi hai, chutti hai, aaj to holiday hai. Right, that is the mood. So just relax, waste time. Wasting time is considered as a luxury. So, but if we see holiday, one way to spell that is H-O-L-I-D-A-Y, holiday. Replace I with Y. H-O-L-Y-D-A-Y, holiday. So consider your those free days as holiday. Because all these days we are complaining. I don't have time. I don't have time for these things. I'm too busy. Isn't it? When I will have time, then I will do something for bhakti, then I will go to temple, then I will go to satsang. I'm too busy. And when the free time comes, that also we waste. So that holiday, it's not H-O-L-I-D-A-Y, it is H-O-L-Y-D-A-Y. So consider that as a very holiday to utilize that time in some better way, rather than just wasting it. Because one moment of time wasted, it doesn't come back. No matter if you try to buy that lost moment with the whole wealth of the world, you cannot bring that lost moment back. Can somebody buy the lost time? You can buy anything in the world, you cannot buy the time, and you cannot buy the happiness actually. So people in this world, they are struggling hard, they are working hard to enjoy, to find that happiness in the world. But real happiness, where does the real happiness lies? We are trying to find happiness on the bodily platform. Isn't it? By eating nice food, by wearing nice clothes, by going to nice vacation places, tourism places, by buying fancy things, giving nice gifts to others, receiving nice gifts from others. This is where we try to find happiness. But that happiness is a very flickering happiness. It doesn't last. There is no happiness in that actually. What we learn in this world, that can teach you how to earn income, how to earn money. Right? What we learn in schools and colleges, that is called academic education. Academic education can teach you how to work for others, how to earn your livelihood. But it does not teach how to make our life successful. Because academic education teaches, if you get a good degree, you go to good college, you get good education, you get good job, you will be successful. Is that really a success? How many of you think that is success?
One way of feeling it is success.
One way of looking at it, if you look from the corporate ladder point of view, right, that is success. I'm climbing up the corporate ladder. I joined as a training engineer, then I become as a actual lead engineer, then I become as a tech specialist or manager or the senior manager or the director or the VP or whatnot. I'm climbing up the corporate ladder. So we consider it as a success. But how many of you think those people really are happy in life? See, there is value education and there is academic education. Okay, academic education can teach you how you can earn little money. But there is big problem with that academic education. It does not teaches you how to face the problems in life. So many successful people, if their power, if their position is removed, if somebody who is the vice president of company, who is the CEO of company, if he loses his job, what is the situation? He cannot handle that situation. He is thinking, how will I show face in the world? What happened to me? I lost my job. I lost this. I lost that. So many people in a big, big position, if they lost something in life, they are completely broken. And some of them, they commit suicide because they do not know how to handle that situation, that problem of life. So academic education, it does not teach us how to face life, how to lead a meaningful, dynamic, successful life. And contrary to academic education is value education. Academic education plus learning the actual values of life. Academic education is just like you are building a tall building. You are building a huge skyscraper, but there is no foundation to that. What will happen to that tall building? If some storm comes, it will break. If there is another building which is tall skyscraper building but a very deep solid foundation that can withstand all the problems, external problems, right? So value education is like that. We want to grow in life, but you want to have deep values of life. And what is that value education? Along with our material education, learning the real purpose of life. What is the real purpose of life? How to get the real success, real happiness in life? How to face the problems of life? How to attain love of God? So that is value-based education. So along with the academic education, we need to gain that value-based education. And that value-based education is what is given from scriptures, what we learn from scriptures. We are too busy teaching our kids also this academic education. Right? As the kids turn 5 years, we send them to school. They better learn math, learn physics, learn science, learn social study. Know all these things, but we do not focus much on this value-based education. These days anyway, it's nuclear family concept, right? There are no real values of family relationship, respecting others, serving others. So academic education versus value-based education, there is a vast difference. We send our kids for so many different classes, swimming classes or horse riding and this and that, football, basketball, so many different things, right? We are interested in all those sort of activities, but we are not interested in teaching our kids spiritual education, which is the real need for the society. So that's why when we come to satsang program, our purpose is learning ourselves and training our kids from early age. So they can grow understanding the real value of life and become real successful in life. If you want to understand the world is described as pavarga. How many of you know Devanagari script? You have learned Devanagari script? What is Devanagari script? Ka kha ga gha na, cha cha ja ja, ta tha da dha na, pa pha bha bha ma. Right? That is Devanagari. So every line of Devanagari, it is referred as varga starting with the first letter. So ka varga, pa varga, ta varga, like that. So pa varga. That describes the situation of the world. What is the pavarga? What are the letters in that pavarga? Pa, pha, bha, bha, ma. So pa. Pa refers to parishram. Everybody is trying to work hard, right? Do parishram. What are we taught from the school from early age? Work hard, study hard, get good grades, go to college, study hard, get good degree, go to job, work hard, earn good money, get good position. So parishram, work hard, that will make you successful in life. So pa, and then comes next letter, pa. Pa means pena, form. When somebody works hard, at night they sleep, there is so many foam coming out from the mouth. क्या बोलते हैं उसको झाग निकलना. किसी ने अपना पिल्लो चेक किया कभी? क्या मुंह से saliva निकलता है, it becomes wet. And have you seen the cow or the bull, right? They work hard. The bull work hard in the field. And the bull while sitting freely, he is just chewing something. मुंह चलता रहता, जुगाली करते रहते, उसको बोलते हैं जुगाली करना. And then there's foaming from the mouth. झाग निकलता है. So when somebody works really hard, then they foam at the mouth because of tiredness. They are so tired. So pa, ba is vyarth. So much things we try to collect in the world. Ultimately, it all goes waste. So va is vyarth. How it goes waste? You cannot take anything with you. Right? Whatever you earn in this life, it will just stay here. It will pass from one person to another person. So, pa, ba, then comes bha. Bha is bhai, fear. Anybody in this world who claims I am free from fear? This is the biggest problem of this world, right? Fear. Fear of what? Fear of so many things. Somebody has collected more, he has fear of losing it. Somebody has nothing, he has fear of gaining it. Somebody is beautiful, he has fear of losing his beauty, his youth. Somebody has some position, he has fear of losing his position. Somebody has fear of thieves. Somebody has fear of government. They will take everything in tax. They will collect from me everything in tax. So always there is fear. And then, so pa, ba, bha, ma. That is the end of life. Mrityu. At the end, everybody has to face death. Nobody can escape from death. No matter how much somebody tried. Hiranyakashipu tried. Ravana tried. Everybody tried and they failed. They said, we can become immortal. But nobody can escape death. So that is the reality of life. The world, this life can be described as pa-varga. Pa-pa-ba-bha-ma. And if we want to become successful in life, we need to go beyond this pa-varga. That is called up-varga. Up-varga, where you don't meet with this cycle. Keep trying to work hard in this life. One life to another life, one passing on. At the end, one has to face the death. So if we want to go beyond that cycle of birth, death, old age, disease, then that's called upavarga. So that's why Prabhupada went from pa-pa-bha-bha-ma to ABCD. What is ABCD? So we teach our kids Hindi alphabets also, Devanagari, and you learn ABCD also. So from pa-varga to ABCD, what is ABCD? A, Association of Devotees. Being in the right association, being with the right set of people, with the right mindset, who are also trying to learn the values of life. So along with that, we learn the values of life. So association of devotees. B, books, reading scriptures, getting the knowledge from scriptures. C, chanting of the holy name. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So when we chant the holy name, what does it do? What is the purpose of chanting the holy name?
Purifying
ourselves. Okay.
Requesting God allowing me to serve you.
We are requesting the Lord to engage us in your service. So chanting has many benefits. Actually, whatever we said, those are the side benefits. Those are not the real benefits of chanting. Those are, they just come. Those are given as a side benefit. What is the real benefit of chanting? Real purpose of chanting. Real purpose of chanting is to develop love for Krishna. Real purpose of chanting is so we can chant more. When you develop love for Krishna, then you want to chant more. Right? Whom you love, you want to say his name. So that is the real purpose of chanting. But getting peace of mind, getting purity of heart, getting freedom from all the problems of life, those are side benefits. So our goal should not be striving for those things. Our goal is, I want to develop love for Krishna so that I can chant more. So now also we are chanting. Now our chanting is maybe just abhas matra, just as a reflection. And when you develop love of God, then the real chanting starts. Right now it's in the practice stage. So right now we are practicing. Ultimately you want to do the actual chanting. So from A, B, C chanting and D, D is diet. Not the diet, okay, don't eat food for 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. I'm on dieting. I need to lose weight. Not that dieting. Diet means the proper food. What is the proper food? Which is offered to Krishna. When you offer first to the Lord, that is bhoga. And then you take that, honor that prasad. Because prasad, that purifies our senses. That purifies our consciousness. So we should make that as a practice at home. Whatever we cook, we should try to offer to the Lord. Whatever fruits you get from the market, first offer it to the Lord. Milk you get from the market, offer it to the Lord. And then take that as prasad. So Prabhupada gave us this ABCD, which will help us become free from this cycle of birth, death, disease, old age. And attain the real purpose of life. So now we enter into our Krishna Katha. That was a little detour because Akrurji took many detours. So Akrur is sent by Kamsa to bring Krishna and Balram to Mathura. Okay, in the last session we discussed this one. And why Kamsa sent Akrura to bring Krishna and Balram? Because Narad Muni came to Kamsa and told, actually Krishna, he is not the son of Nanda and Yashoda. He is the son of Vasudeva and Devaki, who was at the time of birth, he was delivered at the house of Yashoda Mata. So Kamsa, when he came to know the reality of Krishna, he made many plans to kill Krishna. Now I will not leave Krishna. He sent so many asuras. He lined up many different ways to kill Krishna. He sent Keshi immediately. You go and try to kill Krishna. And after Keshi, he lined up another demon, Vyomasura. And then he called his people that prepare for the yajna for Kalabhairava. We will bring Krishna Balram here in Mathura and we will kill them as a sacrifice in front of Kalabhairava. Then he called his elephant rider, the driver of Kuvalyapida, that you stay ready, keep the elephant ready to stomp on Krishna and Balram. Unko muscle dena, hathi ke pairon ke tale. And then he called his wrestlers, Chanur, Mushtik, that there will be a wrestling match. We'll call Krishna and Balram on the plea of a wrestling match to watch that wrestling match and then we'll kill them. So he lined up so many different ways. And then he called Akrurji, you go to Vrindavan and bring Krishna and Balram on the pretext of enjoying, watching this city, watching these festival. And he presented a new golden chariot to Akrurji. See, I'm giving you this nice chariot, you go. Akrura in his mind, he's very happy. He's thinking at least he gave new chariot, which was a good offering for Krishna, for Krishna to ride as a new chariot, a bhoga for Krishna. When you offer something to Krishna, you offer which is not used by anybody, right? So Kansa has done a good service. He has offered this new chariot. So Naraji, he came to Kamsa on the day of Ekadashi. And Akarurji started his journey to Vrindavan on the next day morning, Dwadashi. So Dwadashi morning, Akrura started his journey to Vrindavan. And that day, Krishna's last day in Vrindavan, Krishna killed those two demons, Keshi and Vyoma. And by the evening time, Akarurji reached Vrindavan. Now, how many of you have been to Vrindavan? Anybody went to Vrindavan?
Yeah.
Okay, one, two. So you have gone to all the places around Vrindavan? Mm-hmm. Vrindavan, Nandgaon, Mathura, Govardhan.
Yes.
So from Vrindavan to Mathura, how far is that? Approximately about 30 kilometer, 30 minute, 40 minute you will reach.
Yes.
Right? If you take auto rickshaw or a taxi,
yes,
you will reach 30 to 45 minutes.
Yes.
So from Mathura to Vrindavan, 30 to 40 minutes. For Akrurji, it took whole day. He started in the morning, early in the morning, and he reached in the evening. He is not going on foot. He is riding a horse chariot. Why did Akrur took so long? What happened to Akrurji?
He wanted to spend more time.
He kept getting down from his chariot every
evening. With Krishna.
With Krishna, no, but from morning till evening, it took in the journey. Right? If you go, you will reach in 40 minutes, 45 minutes. For Akrurji, it took 8 to 10 hours maybe. And he is going on a nice horse chariot.
Puncture ho gaya tha.
There are no punctured wheels on that, right? It's a horse chariot. And our cars we call as how much horsepower you have. Right? Horsepower. Based on how many horses are there in the chariot, that's how the car's horsepower is determined. If this is equivalent to a chariot with these many horses, four horses, one horse, two horse. So Akrurji, he was so much absorbed in thinking about Krishna. He was so much absorbed in his mood of devotion, he lost his thought of way, where he is going. He is going this way, then coming, realizing, coming back, going another way, then coming back. So he is just going here and there, just so much absorbed in thinking about Krishna. That's why it is evening time, by the time Akrurji reached Vrindavan. So when you go to Vrindavan, we don't have to imitate the mood of Akrurji. Let me just absorb in the thoughts and lose my way. I will tell I reached from Mathura to Vrindavan in one day. No, you take the shortest flight. Try to reach Delhi and from there go to Vrindavan. We don't want to imitate. But yes, we have lessons to learn. From the mood of Akrurji, there are so many lessons to learn. What should be our mood when we go to Vrindavan? When you plan your trip to Vrindavan? So the first lesson, Akrurji has a deep mood of devotion. We cannot go to Vrindavan just physically. Oh, physically I have entered in Vrindavan. Here, Vrindavan, here I come. Right? And people write on their t-shirt, I lost my heart in Vrindavan. It's not just writing on the t-shirt. It is how much devotion you carry in your heart. We can go to Vrindavan through our mood of devotion. We cannot go to actually Vrindavan by plane or by taxi or by auto rickshaw or anything. Physically, yes, you can go with these things. But real entry to Vrindavan is when you have that right mindset, right mood, right emotion in the heart. Otherwise, we go to Vrindavan, we see there all around, we see, oh, there is so much dust, there is so much garbage there is so many naliyan hain, kichad hai. सुअर कीचर में लौट रहे हैं. वी जस्ट सी ऑल दैट एंड कम बैक. हाँ, मैंने वृंदावन देख लिया. नो, यू हैव नॉट सीन वृंदावन. सो फर्स्ट लेसन इज टू हैव दैट राइट माइंड सेट, द हार्ट फुल विद डिवोशन. हियरिंग अबाउट वृंदावन बिफोर यू गो टू वृंदावन, हियरिंग अबाउट वृंदावन, वेरियस पास्ट टाइम्स ऑफ कृष्णा. सो अब्सॉर्बिंग योर सेल्फ इन द मूड ऑफ वृंदावन. I remember my first trip to Vrindavan. First time I went to Vrindavan was maybe 2009. And that was by far the best trip to Vrindavan. First trip. Because before going to Vrindavan, and that was in US, and it was a time of recession, right? We were just recovering from the first recession. People have lost jobs and people were afraid of traveling outside the country. If we go outside, we will not be able to come back.
2008.
2008, first recession. So that was the time when I was planning to travel to India. And my company HR, the lawyer, they said, no, don't travel. It's very dangerous to go right now because getting stamping back, H1 stamping and all is very difficult. I have travel plan to India and I want to go. I don't want to cancel that trip. And we had the plan to go to Vrindavan. So somehow that mood was there, complete absorption. Hearing, so that time I heard the whole Vrindavan Yatra series, every lecture. I heard 50 lectures, 1 hour lectures before traveling to Vrindavan to kind of understand the mood of Vrindavan. What go this place, check mark. This place, check mark. I need to go this place, check mark. I need to go to, what is that market? Right, famous market where people go for shopping. Lohi Bazaar. I need to go to Lohi Bazaar, do some nice shopping, buy some nice t-shirts. I lost my heart in Vrindavan. So otherwise it just becomes like that kind of trip where you go for not really seeing Krishna but doing shopping. Right, fulfilling your checklist. So having that deep mood of absorption. And then second point, when Akrura is traveling, he is thinking, how fortunate I am. What is this good fortune that I am able to go to Vrindavan? I will be able to see Krishna face to face. How I got this good fortune? What kind of austerity I may have done to receive that kind of fortune, what kind of charity I may have done, what kind of other pious activities I may have performed, because of which I have got this opportunity to go to Vrindavan, that I will see Krishna there, I will be able to meet Krishna, I will be able to meet all the Brajabasis, I will be able to take darshan of Krishna. So we should also feel that way. What kind of good fortune I got, that I am able to go to Vrindavan. How good fortunate it is that I will be able to see Krishna. Now somebody may question, yes, a crude style, Krishna was there personally, right? 5,000 years ago, Krishna was personally there. So Akrurji saw Krishna there. But now when I go, where will I see Krishna? So Krishna is present in Vrindavan till now also. When Akrurji took Krishna from Vrindavan to Mathura, externally, physically, yes, Krishna left Vrindavan and with the Akrurji he went to Mathura. But Krishna never leaves Vrindavan. Krishna says actually in the scripture, there is a very wonderful statement. Leave Vrindavan. I do not take one step out of Vrindavan. Vrindavanam parityajya padam ekam na gacchami. So Krishna always resides in Vrindavan. Even though when Krishna winds up his leela, Krishna is still there in Vrindavan in his unmanifested form. He is not visible to others' eyes, but Krishna is present there in Vrindavan. And there are so many other ways we can see Krishna. How do we see Krishna? Krishna can be seen, we see Krishna in the form of his deities. There are so many temples, Krishna's nice, wonderful vigrahas are established, right? Deities of Krishna. So we take darshan of Krishna in his vigraha form. Because Vigraha is non-different from Krishna. Actually, when you're standing in front of Vigraha of the Lord, you should feel you're standing in front of Krishna. You're taking darshan of Krishna. And then you associate with Krishna in the form of His holy name. You associate with Krishna through the association of devotees. So that is the right opportunity we have when we visit Vrindavan. Vrindavan, every step is like doing the production of the whole world. Walking on in this land of Vrindavan is performing like austerities. Even sleeping in Vrindavan is like meditation. It doesn't mean that you go to Vrindavan and sleep. It is just saying that if just sleeping in Vrindavan is so glorious, if you perform austerity, if you chant the holy name of Krishna there, how wonderful that is. So we associate with Krishna. Krishna is still present there in His unmanifested form. He is not visible to anybody, but He is there. He still performs His leela. There are places in Vrindavan where people say Krishna still come every night. Right? There is a place called Nidhivan. There is a place called Seva Kunj. So Nidhivan, where Krishna still comes and performs His Rasa Leela every night. And the Seva Kunj is the area where Krishna goes with Radharani and He takes rest there. They still decorate the bed for Radha Krishna. They put flowers, they put paan for Krishna. And every morning when they open the door, everything is used. Okay, it's not that somebody came and ate all that. So if you go 6 o'clock in the morning, Seva Kunj, they will open the door and they will show you the darshan. So these places are still there. And at night, nobody is allowed entrance there. Even the monkeys leave that place. Because if somebody saw Krishna, if somebody is witnessing those pastimes, they are filled with so much ecstasy, they go crazy. From external vision, it looks like a madman. If pagal aadmi mein aur bhakt mein zyada fark nahi hota. If somebody has gone to that level of ecstasy, it becomes like a crazy person, madman. From external vision, somebody will think, oh, this guy is crazy. But he is filled with so much ecstasy, he is not able to even speak a word. So this is how you associate with Krishna, and one should think how good fortune I have that I got this opportunity to travel to Vrindavan. And then the third lesson. So what is the first lesson? Mood of devotion. Second is feeling yourself so fortunate. The third lesson, even though you are so fortunate, you got that opportunity, one should feel himself most unqualified. Oh, I'm such a wretched person. I'm so simple person. I'm the lowest than lowest. Still, I got this opportunity to go to Vrindavan. And that is because of the mercy of Krishna. I am very disqualified, unqualified. Out of just the mercy of Krishna, mercy of the Vaishnavas, mercy of Guru Maharaj, I am able to go to Vrindavan. Because Krishna, He can remove all the sins. So that's how the devotee should feel himself most fallen. Right? Our acharyas, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, Bhakti Vinod Thakur, Gaur Kishore Das Babaji, all these great, great acharyas, devotees, they show that deep mood of humility. I am nobody. Even though they have done such a great things, they consider themselves as, I am nobody. I am very fallen. Even if you, how many of you know the pastime of Sudama? Right? Sudama visiting Dwarika to see Krishna. Sudama was a poor Brahmana. He had a vow that he will go to five doors, five houses. Whatever he gets from those five doors, that's what he will accept. If he doesn't get anything, he will not go to the next door. And sometime he doesn't get anything, so there is nothing to eat at his home. The kids are hungry, so one day, Sudama's wife, she pleaded with Sudama. You say Krishna is your friend. You go to Krishna. And Sudama said, no, I don't want to go. I don't want to ask anything from Krishna. And his wife said, you just go. Don't ask anybody. Krishna, He Himself will give you, he will shower his mercy. You are his friend from his childhood. He is the king of Dwarika, and he will be having mercy towards his friend. So you don't have to ask anything. So Sudama traveled all the way from where to where? Where did Sudama reside? Nobody knows the place of Sudama?
Porbandar.
Good. So Sudama traveled from there all the way to Dwarika, and as he reached, we know the pastime, that the doorkeeper stopped him. They did not let him in. You want some charity, we will arrange for charity. Sudama said, I am friend of Krishna, and people laughed at him.
How they become friend is in Porbandar?
No, they were living together at the ashram of Sandipani Muni.
Oh.
They studied together.
Oh.
College, school time friends. Okay. So he said, I am friend of Krishna, and nobody believed him. Kahan tum, kahan Krishna? There is no relation. Koi talmeli nahi hai. There is no, how can that be friendship? And then Sudama pleaded, please go, just give the message. And the doorkeeper, the guard, he went to Krishna and told one person with tattered clothes, torn clothes, there is no kurta on his body, he is having dhoti with so many holes in that, looks like very pale, he is very weak, he has not eaten for days, and he claims himself to be your friend. Krishna said, my friend? What is his name? Did he tell his name? His name is Sudama. As soon as Krishna heard the word Sudama, Krishna lost his external senses and he ran towards the door. No consideration if he is wearing the crown, if he is wearing the shoes, and where his jewelry is going, where his clothes are going. He is running and kind of bumping into the servants, the doorkeepers. So Krishna brought him inside. Krishna served Sudama. Krishna made Sudama sit on his throne. He washed his feet. All the queens, Rukmani Devi, Satyabhama, they are thinking, who is this poor Brahmana? And Krishna is serving him. So he served him, he washed his feet, he fed him nice food, he made him take shower, put him nice clothes, and gave good place to stay. And then of course Sudama had brought something with him. What was that?
Puff rice,
sattu, tandoor. Right? People call it different names. So Krishna snatched that. Sudama was hesitant to give that. So just imagine. Sudama's wife had put those sattu, those puffed rice. She went to neighbors' houses. Whatever little bit rice she got, she packed everything together. And made a potli. And Sudama is holding that potli, right, on his waist, under his cloth, in his dhoti. And he has traveled all the way. All the sweat and everything is going in that potli too. With the sweat and all the tandoor is with that sweaty, that watery, sweat water, right? And then Krishna snatched that. Oh, you are hiding something from me.
Actually, he asked for a gift. What did you, hey, Sudama?
Right, so Krishna is, because Krishna knows that Sudama is hesitant to give whatever gift he has brought for me. So Krishna is playing with him. My sister-in-law, Bhabhi ne kuch to diya hoga. Right? So give it to me. And Sudama said, no, there's nothing. And Krishna snatched from his waist. And then Krishna ate that. Just imagine. Love of Krishna. Krishna has no scarcity. Is Krishna scared, having scarcity of any food? And this tandoor, it's mixed with the sweat of Sudama and everything for... It's kind of what we call as stale for so many days. And Krishna is eating that. With each bite, what Krishna is taking, Krishna is granting the opulences to Sudama. But Krishna did not show it externally to Sudama that I have given you so many gifts. Because he did not want to make Sudama feel that inferiority complex. And Sudama, while he is traveling back, at that time also, Sudama is not thinking, oh, Krishna did not give me any gift. What is Sudama thinking? He is thinking about his good fortune. How fortunate I am. How merciful is Krishna. There is a very beautiful verse in Bhagavatam which comes later in this pastime of Sudama, where Sudama is counting on to his good fortune. Kaha main, kaha Krishna. Exactly, this is the words of Sudama. Kaha main, kaha Krishna. So Sudama says, Kwaham dridraha papiyan, kwaha Krishna shri niketana, brahma bandur iti smaham, bahubhyam parirambhita. Sudama is saying, Kwaham dridra, kaha main, itna garib vyakti, so poor. Papiyan, I am such a sinful person because my poverty is the proof of my sins. Because of my sins, I am such a poor person. So Sudama is saying, I am such a poverty-stricken person. I am so sinful. And kaha Krishna? Kaha Shri Niketana? He is the abode of wealth. Lakshmipati. Shri Niketana. But Krishna has given so much mercy to me, considering me as a Brahmana. Not actually, he is not saying I am a Brahmana. He is saying Brahma Bandhur. Jaise bolte hai, Dvij Bandhu, the servant of the Brahmana, the Sevak of Brahmana. So I am just a poor Brahmana, Sevak, servant of Brahmanas. But Krishna, out of his mercy, he has embraced me. Krishna ne mera alingan kiya. That is the mercy of Krishna. So we should also feel that way. I have got opportunity to go to Krishna, to Vrindavan, to holy places, but I have no qualification. It is just because of mercy of Krishna. In Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is very beautiful verse. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Sansara bhramite kona bhagya keha tare, nadira pravahe yena kashtha lage tire. Sansara bhramite kono bhagya keha tare. In this world, wandering through this world, some is very fortunate that he is freed from this world, sansara, like a wooden log floating in the river, sometime reaches the other shore. What is the probability of a wooden log, just a wooden log keep floating in the river, that it will reach the other shore? Right? Hundreds of miles away, if the other end of the river is, what is the probability of that wooden log that it will reach that shore? Because the waves come sometime this way, sometime other way. It just keep tossing around in the waves, floating in the river. But because of the mercy that somebody is able to reach the other shore. So same way, a person while wandering in the forest, because of the mercy of Krishna, because of the mercy of Guru, one is able to go beyond this sansara. Brahmand bhramite kono bhagyavan jeev, Guru Krishna prasadit paya bhakti lata bij. With the mercy of Guru, with the mercy of Krishna, while wandering in this world, in this material world, one gets bhakti lata bij, the seed of devotion. One engages in this process of bhakti and one can make his life successful. So Akrura is feeling, I am very sinful. I have no qualification. But I have got this mercy that I am able to go to Vrindavan, take darshan of Krishna. And then next, the fourth lesson, Akrura is meditating on the footprints of Krishna. He is meditating on the footsteps of Krishna, on the lotus feet of Krishna. And why Akrura is meditating on the lotus feet of Krishna? So he is remembering that when I go to Vrindavan, when I reach Vrindavan, I will be able to see the earth, the ground, decorated with the footsteps of Krishna. In the footstep of Krishna, there are so many different symbols. We discussed that in detail during Kaliya Leela. Right? What are the different symbols in the foots of Krishna? How the Brajavasis recognizes that these are the footprints of Krishna, not somebody else's footprints. And nobody steps onto the footprints of Krishna. Because everybody, they value anything related to Krishna, they value it so much. So nobody steps on to the footprints of Krishna. So Akrura is also meditating on the lotus feet of Krishna. I will be able to take darshan of the lotus feet of Krishna. And what are the signs in the lotus feet of Krishna? Any signs, any few signs you remember?
Shankha, chakra.
There is a sign of Shankha, Chakra, Umbrella, Padma, Elephant God. The rod with which the Mahavat controls the elephant. Elephant God is called God, G-O-D-E.
Ankush.
Yes. And then there is a barley corn. There is pots of water. There is swastika sign. So there are so many signs like that, and we discussed in detail. Each sign has a significance. What does it represent? So Akrura is meditating on the lotus feet of Krishna. Same way our absorption should be that I will be able to see the footprints of Krishna. See, Krishna had the footprints in Vrindavan. Vrindavan is the place on this whole earth where Krishna left his footprint. Krishna decorated the earth with his footprint. Nowhere else Krishna walked barefoot. Krishna went to Mathura, Krishna went to Dwarika. That time Krishna was not walking barefoot. Only in Vrindavan, Krishna walked barefoot in Vrindavan, in the streets of Vrindavan, in the Raja of Vrindavan. Why? Because Krishna performed the pastime of Gopal, Vatsapal. He is taking care of the cows. Mother Yashoda, when Krishna got the promotion from Vatsapal to Gopal, पहले तो छोटे छोटे बच्चों का देखभाल करते थे फिर उन्होंने बोला अभी गाय का देखभाल करना है सो गॉट प्रमोशन सो फर्स्ट डे व्हेन कृष्णा इज टेकिंग द काउज टू हर्ड द काउज इन द फॉरेस्ट मदर यशोदा टोल्ड यू शुड वेयर फुटवेयर शूज एंड कृष्णा डिनाइड नो आई डोंट वांट टू वेयर एनी फुटवेयर इफ यू वांट मी टू वेयर फुटवेयर शूज यू हैव टू मेक अरेंजमेंट फॉर ऑल द काउज 9 lakh गाय एंड एवरी काउ हैज 2 पेयर ऑफ फुट्स राइट फोर सो हाउ हु विल मेक दोज चलो बना भी दिए तो पहनाएगा कौन रोज रोज इवन कृष्णा इज इन मथुरा कृष्णा इज इन द्वारिका कृष्णा हैज अ बिग आर्मी नारायणी सेना सो एट दैट टाइम कृष्णा इज नॉट सेइंग दैट ओके फर्स्ट मेक फुटप्रिंट्स फुटवेयर्स फॉर एवरीबडी इफ माई सोल्जर्स विल वेयर फुटवेयर्स देन आई विल ऑल्सो वेयर सो एवरीबडी इज वेयरिंग फुटवेयर्स एट लीस्ट देर इज नो टेंशन दे कैन वेयर देमसेल्फ बट फॉर द काउज Who will make them wear, who will remove their shoes again, put the shoes every day. So Mother Yashoda said, it's too much, leave it. So Krishna walked barefoot only in Vrindavan. The land of Vrindavan is so fortunate, it is decorated with the footprints of Krishna. See, in Vaikuntha also, Lord Vishnu, he wears footprint, right? He wears footwear. Bhagavan bhi juti pehante hai. Only in Vrindavan, Krishna walked barefoot. So Akrura is meditating, I will be able to see those lotus footprints of Krishna. So he is meditating on the lotus feet of Krishna. And then the fifth point, Akrura is meditating on the beauty of Krishna. Such a beautiful face of Krishna, the blackish bluish complexion. With his side glances, he look at the Brajabasis. Everybody is charmed by the beauty of Krishna, by the smile of Krishna, by the side glances of Krishna. And the gopis actually, they complain to Brahmaji. The gopis, they chastise Brahmaji. Somebody may think, oh, this is so offensive. How can the gopis chastise Brahmaji? Gopis are saying Brahma's creation is faulty. There is a fault in Brahma's creation. Brahma made this body, Brahma made these eyes. Why did Brahma put this eyelid? Ye unhone palke kyun banayi? Because Brahma made these eyelids and these eyelids keep blinking. Right? You can try to keep your eyes without blinking. For how long you can keep? So these eyelids, they keep blinking. And gopis are complaining because these eyelids are blinking every few seconds and for that much time we are bereft from taking darshan of Krishna. We are not able to see Krishna. So we are losing that much of momentarily darshan of Krishna. And we are not able to see the beauty of Krishna for that much time. So Akrura is meditating on the beautiful form, beautiful face of Krishna, that when I go, I will take darshan of Krishna. And when we sing that Damodar Ashtakam, in Damodar Ashtakam also it describes the beautiful face of Krishna. Kartik month is coming now, and starting in what, 10-12 days from October 20th. Right, from October 20th, Damodar month, Kartik month is starting. And that month is called Damodar because the Lord's form, tied as a baby with the grinding mortar. That is the form of Krishna which is known as Damodar. So this Damodar Leela, this happened in the month of Kartik. Actually on the day of Diwali, this Leela happened. So this whole month is called Damodar month, Kartik month. And we offer lamp to Lord Damodar, that particular form of Krishna tied with the grinding mortar. And we sing a prayer which is called Damodar Ashtakam. So that also describes the beauty of Krishna. That Krishna's lips are reddish like the bimba fruit. And Mother Yashoda kisses Krishna's cheeks, and Krishna's cheeks are reddish. Krishna's hair, the curly hairs are touching the cheeks of Krishna. Krishna ke jo ghungrale baal hain, wo unki गालों को छू रहे हैं, भगवान की जो अलकावली है. सो इन दैट वे अक्रूरा इज रिमेम्बरिंग कृष्णा, कृष्णा'स ब्यूटी. सो एवरीथिंग ऑफ कृष्णा इज डिस्क्राइब्ड एज लोटस, लोटस लाइक आईज, लोटस लाइक हैंड्स, लोटस लाइक नेवल, लोटस लाइक फीट. व्हाई इट्स ऑल कंपेयर्ड एज अ लोटस, जहां पर भगवान को बोलते हैं ना कमल नयन, कमल नेत्र, कमल कर कमल. व्हाई इट्स कंपेयर्ड विद लोटस?
यू ओरिएंटेड फ्रॉम, यू ऑफर लोटस
टू गॉड. यस, वी ऑफर लोटस. ओके,
नथिंग इज एज प्रीटी एज लोटस इन द फ्लावर.
वेरी गुड, दैट इज वन ऑफ द रीजन. लोटस, इफ यू वांट टू स्पीक एनीथिंग ब्यूटीफुल इन दिस वर्ल्ड, lotus is considered as very beautiful. So anything comparing in terms of beauty, it's compared as a lotus, lotus eyes. And second reason is actually lotus is very soft, komal. Ek to usko kamal bolte hain aur dusre upar se wo komal hai ki komal kamal. So the feet of Krishna, they are also considered as very soft. The whole body of Krishna is very soft. So that is another reason it's compared with the lotus. And the third reason, lotus, the name for lotus is called Pankaja. Panka, Panka is kichad. Ja, which is born from that. So the lotus, it is born in a muddy water. Right? So the lotus stay in the muddy water, it's called, that's why it's called Pankaja, but it is untouched by that muddy water. Even if you put water on lotus, not a single drop of water will stay on the leaf, on the petals of lotus. It will just glide down. So lotus stays in mud, but it is unaffected by that mud. Keechad mein rehte hue bhi keechad se anchua hai. So same way Krishna, Krishna is purest of pure, but Krishna is not contaminated by any impurity of this world. Krishna can remove all the impurity from the heart of the devotees. In our heart there is so much impurity. Krishna removes all that impurity, but Krishna is untouched by that impurity. So that's why Krishna is called unfallen. Right? What is that word? Achyuta, who does not fall down from his position. That's another name for Krishna, Achyuta. So Krishna is compared, every limb of Krishna's body is compared with a lotus flower. So Akrura is meditating in that way. So we discussed how many points?
Five.
First one, let's recap. Devotion in the heart. Second, how fortunate I am. Third,
fortunate I am fallen.
But I am still so fallen, right? It's because of the mercy that I have got this benefit or this
opportunity
to go to Vrindavan. So Akrura was even thanking Kamsa. Kamsa is so merciful on me. Kamsa has given me this opportunity. Kamsa has asked me to go to Vrindavan. I will be able to take darshan of Krishna and Balram. So we should also feel in that way. Thankful to everybody, that everybody is so merciful on me. Whoever has done some good thing for me, for making my travel to Vrindavan, or somebody has tortured me also, actually they are merciful to me. Because they have tortured me so much, I have got this little vairagya from the world, and I am trying to connect with Krishna. I am trying to take more shelter, deeper shelter of Krishna. So everybody is very merciful on me. Akrura is thanking Kamsa. Kamsa is so merciful. Now Kamsa is merciful. But Akrura is saying Kamsa is so merciful. Because of him, I have got this opportunity to go to Vrindavan. So considering ourselves very fallen, and it is just the mercy because of which I am able to go. Then fourth, meditating on the lotus feet of Krishna. Fifth, meditating on the beauty of Krishna. And then sixth, Akrura is saying, as soon as I go to Vrindavan, I see Krishna, I will fall at the feet of Krishna, I will jump down from my chariot, I will fall at the feet of Krishna, I will pay my sakshat dandvat pranam, I will pay obeisances to all the cowherd boyfriends of Krishna, I will pay obeisances to all the brajabasis. So that should be our mood. When we go to Vrindavan, as soon as we reach the outskirts of Vrindavan, just the entrance of Vrindavan, get down from your vehicle. If you are riding in a car or rickshaw or scooter, whatever it is, get down and pay obeisances in the dust of Vrindavan. This is the holy place where Krishna has resided. So paying obeisances there, paying obeisances to the Brajabasis, being very respectful towards others. Because paying obeisances, that is also one of the process of bhakti. Archanam Vandanam, right? Vandanam. And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says actually, anybody remembers 927 or it's 934? What does Krishna say as a conclusion? What should we do? No, that is 926. Patram Pushpam Palam Toyam. 934. Man Mana Bhava. What is that? Next.
Madhyachi
Mam. Mama? Mama? Namaskuru. Okay, what is that? Mama Namaskuru. Pay obeisances unto me. Right? Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that you pay obeisances unto me. So obeisances, paying obeisances, there are different ways you pay obeisances. People go to temple and they are standing in front of Krishna like this. The difficulty of folding hands also. And they're just standing like that. Another way is just, at least people fold their hand and they just bow their head. That is another way of paying obeisances. Namaskar. Right, when we, in India, when we greet each other, what do you call? Namaskar. Corona ne to namaskar ko famous kar diya. Rather than shaking hand, it's better to do namaskar. Don't touch hand with anybody. But when you pay obeisances to the Lord, we should pay sakshat as a dandavat pranam. It's called dandavat or ashtanga pranam. Right? Where the, your whole body, you fall in front of the Lord like a stick. All the limbs, your feet, your knees, your chest, or your waist, your chest, your head and your hand outstretched outside, all flat on the ground. So that is called dandavat pranam. So for men, that is the system actually in scripture. When we pay obeisances to the Lord, it should be as a dandavat pranam. And for Mataji, it's called panchanga pranam. Right? So just kneeling on the knees, touching your head on the ground, and paying obeisances in that way. So we should pay obeisances to the Lord. Also, we should learn the importance of paying obeisances to others. Akrura is not saying I will pay obeisances to Krishna alone. Akrura is saying I will pay obeisances to all the cowherd boyfriends of Krishna. I will pay obeisances to all the Brajabasis. Because all these Brajabasis, they are devotees of Krishna. They are very special people. So I will pay obeisances to all of them. So we should also learn paying obeisances to the devotees. Paying obeisances to the Guru, to the senior Vaishnavas. It's very important. Right? When we greet each other, face to face also, or during any communication, how we greet? Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Please accept my humble obeisances. Dandavat Pranam. So that is how you exchange with each other. So we should learn in that way. Somebody may say, oh, I pay obeisances, I bow down in front of the Lord only. I do not bow down in front of anybody else. So that is also like ego. That, oh, I will bow down in front of Lord, especially if you consider all the Brahmic religions, like in Christianity or other. They do not bow down in front of anybody. If they see somebody bowing down in front of anybody, they consider it as a slavery. Oh, is it your slave? Why he is bowing down in front of you? Because they don't understand this etiquette. They don't understand the value of this thing. How important it is to pay obeisances, to show respect to others. In India, it's a very natural culture, right? We are taught to bow down and touch the feet of elders. Right? Touch the feet of your parents, touch the feet of your teacher, of your relatives. But in India also, that culture is lost now. How many people really do? How many of our kids really do that? So it's the importance, that is value education. We need to ourselves learn that. Now also, how many of you, when you go to India, how many of you really bow down to your parents? Everybody still does that?
Yeah.
Okay, good, at least you are holding on to that value. And similarly, we should teach that to our children also. And so, learning from the mood of Akrura, bowing down, paying that dandavat pranam. As soon as you enter into Vrindavan, getting down and paying obeisances to the Brajabasis, to the senior Vaishnavas, in our community also, developing that habit, developing that mood of respecting others, offering our obeisances to others. Yes, in front of the deities, in front of the Lord, you do not offer obeisances to anybody else. That is also one of the etiquette. When you are standing in front of the Lord, then you should not offer obeisances. Apart from that, your guru is there. Yes, when the senior devotee Maharaj comes for class, you offer obeisances in the temple room. But in general, you should not pay obeisances to others in front of the Lord. If the curtain is closed, yes, then it's okay. So then, Akarura is thinking, so I will get down, I will jump down from my chariot and I will pay obeisances to Krishna. Then what will Krishna do? Krishna will put his hand on my head. Krishna will bless me. He will put his lotus hand on my head. And that will be the best thing for me. That will be the mercy of Krishna. All my sinful reaction will be eradicated. Then Krishna will embrace me. Krishna will hug me. My dear Akrur, you have come. And Krishna will call my name, my dear Akrura. As soon as I hear this, that is the perfection of my life. Hearing from the Lord, getting that recognition that yes, I reciprocate with you. I appreciate you or I acknowledge you. Just getting that acknowledgement from the Lord, that is like the perfection of life. Everybody here also, they try to get acknowledgement. Right? We want to get acknowledged for our things. If you have done something in your office, you want to get acknowledgement. How many of you work in your office thinking, I don't care if somebody gives me the due credit of my work or not. Let me just do my work. Anybody? So you want to get that acknowledgement. Mataji's work at home, they clean the home, cook, and they want little reciprocation, right? Acknowledgement. husbands will come home and they will acknowledge, yes, house is very clean, you have done so much work hard. And if the husband comes and says, what did you do all day? And Mataji said, but pura din ghar pe itna kaam kiya and you come home and say, what did you do all day? Right? So everybody wants little acknowledgement. But the best acknowledgement is, we should understand that Krishna is acknowledging me. Krishna is seeing everything and Krishna acknowledges. If I have done something little for Krishna, Krishna acknowledges. So we should have that faith. Yes, we ourselves should not be looking for acknowledgement from externally, from others. But we should not think that, oh, I don't need to acknowledge others. They also feel satisfied. They have done something, Krishna is watching. They should not expect acknowledgement from me. So I do not need to acknowledge anybody. It is our duty to acknowledge others, but we should not expect acknowledgement. Is that easy? It is easier to say others actually. Why you are expecting acknowledgement? Right? You should be satisfied. Krishna is watching you, Guru is watching you. You should be satisfied whatever service you are doing. You should not look for acknowledgement. So to speak to others like this, it's very easy. But our duty is to acknowledge others. Whatever somebody is doing, sometimes we miss that aspect. Because in any community, the community is with mutual reciprocation. What makes a temple special? What makes a temple special than other temples? See, deities are there, both places. But if one place is considered very special, very wonderful temple, what makes that temple wonderful? It's Radha Kunj Bihari or Radha Gopijan Ballabh or Radha Madan Mohan or whatever it is. The deities are there, deities are wonderful everywhere. Deities are beautiful. But what makes a temple wonderful? What makes a temple special? Devotees. Devotees are what makes the temple wonderful. What is the mood of the devotees? What is their reciprocation with each other? Are the devotees having that mood of cooperation? Are the devotees free from that envious tendency? Are they willing to work with each other to spread the movement, spread this message? That's what makes a temple special. It is the congregation, it is the community which makes the temple special. So what was the point I was discussing?
Acknowledgement.
Right? So acknowledging other person's service is very important from our point of view. So if somebody is acknowledging one particular category of people and he miss others. There's an example in one temple. Every temple in the morning, they will tell the scores. People go for book distribution, they go for Harinam. And every morning they announce the score. Oh, so many Bhagavad Gita distributed, so many small books distributed, or so many Bhagavatams are distributed. And then everybody acknowledges, they clap. Hari Bol, Hari Bol, so wonderful. So they are acknowledging the service of those devotees who are doing outreach service. Going out and spreading the message of Krishna, spreading the teachings of Krishna. And then sometimes they may miss to acknowledge others who are serving inside, who are doing all the background services, who are serving the deities, who are decorating the deities, who are cooking for the deities, who are making the nice garlands for the deities. So once Mataji came and complained to the temple president, Prabhuji, all these young people, they go outside, they do this outreach service and every morning everybody is clapping, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, they get so much acknowledgement. What about us? We have been serving for 25 years, we have been making garlands. Nobody said Hari Bol for us. Right? So somebody becomes so much focused on one particular area, they miss the acknowledgement service for others. Same way, somebody may be completely opposite. They appreciate the service which is being done related to deities. So they do a lot of appreciation, a lot of acknowledgement for somebody who is doing service for the deities, making garland, going on the altar, cooking for the deities. But they do not appreciate any other services for community outreach, preaching programs, teaching the children. So they miss all that. So there has to be balance, acknowledgement. acknowledgement is a fundamental principle and it's a need for everybody to be acknowledged. But in our heart, we should have that firm faith. Krishna is acknowledging. Krishna is witnessing everything. Krishna is watching. So we should not look for our own appreciation, acknowledgement, but we should not miss to acknowledge others. So Akrura is thinking, Krishna will embrace me. As soon as Krishna says, my dear Akrura, that is the success of my life. And then Krishna and Balram, they will hold my hand and they will take me to their home. So Akruraji came, he went to the house, and so this is all the meditation. Akrura has not yet come to Vrindavan. On the way from Mathura to Vrindavan, this is how he is meditating, and he is so much absorbed in his thought, he is not even focusing where he is going. So his chariot, he just crosses Vrindavan and goes some other way. Then he comes back, goes somewhere else. So finally by evening he reached. And as soon as he reached Vrindavan, he saw the footprints of Krishna in the dust of Vrindavan. Akrura jumped down from his chariot and rolled in the dust of Vrindavan. Not just paying obeisances, he rolled in the dust of Vrindavan. So Acharya says, when we enter Vrindavan, when we go to Vrindavan, you should roll in the dust of Vrindavan. You should forget about who you are. Somebody may be very high class, high position person. Somebody is maybe even the PM or CM or whatever he is. One should forget his material identification. One should roll in the dust of Vrindavan. There are few places specially in Vrindavan. One is called Ramana Reti. Reti, Reti means Reth. Right? Ramana Reti, where Krishna wanders in the dust of Vrindavan. And like that, there is another place, very beautiful, very peaceful place in Vrindavan. During our last trip, I went to that place. I'm forgetting the name again. Very calm place. Filled with the trees.
Nidhivan?
No, not Nidhivan. It's a... I will tell you the name.
Banasur.
Right. Banasur. No. What is Banasur? Sevapanj. Nidhivan, Sevapanj. So I will tell you the name later. But there are places like that. Barasana. Barasana is place of Radharani, where Radharani lived. So one should roll in the dust of Vrindavan. Akrura jumped down from his chariot and he rolled into the dust of Vrindavan. And then he saw Krishna and Balram standing there with his cowherd friends. Akrura came and paid obeisances. Krishna lifted Akrura. Now fast forward, so all that has happened. So Krishna and talked to Akrura. He asked how you are. That you have finally come from Mathura to Vrindavan. How is Kamsa there? Is he behaving good with everybody? But what is the point of asking? We know how Kamsa is. But just as a sweet talks, right? One should offer the sweet words to others. So Krishna is talking to Akrura, asking his welfare. And then finally they took Kamsa at home. Akrura at home. And Akrura told Krishna and Balram his purpose of coming to Vrindavan. That Kamsa has sent him to bring Krishna and Balram to Mathura, and what is his plan? His plan is to kill Krishna and Balram through all these different ways. And Krishna just laughed. Krishna just laughed. So finally Krishna and Balram took Akrura at home. They served Akrura. They washed his feet. So that is how you respect a guest. Now Krishna, he is the Supreme Lord. But he is receiving Akrura as his guest at his home and he is washing his feet. And then they offered him such a wonderful feast. Fed him nicely. After feeding him nicely, Krishna gave him, what do you call at the end? Some paan or saumph.
Mouth freshener.
So Krishna offered some mouth freshener. And then Nand Baba also is sitting there. Nand Baba spoke very pleasantly, very nicely, sweet words with Akrura, asking his welfare. And then Akrura informed what is his purpose of coming. He has come to take Krishna and Balram to Mathura. And everybody, when the news went out, Akrura has come to take Krishna and Balram to Mathura, everybody was so upset. Why Akrura has come here? why did he, why, how can he think of taking Krishna from Vrindavan to Mathura? Krishna is the life of everybody, life of all the Brajvasis. And all the gopis, they are so mad at Akrura. Akrura's name is Akrura. A plus Krura, who is not cruel. But actually this Akrura is very cruel. This name Akrura is not befitting Akrura. By nature, he is very cruel. Because he is thinking of taking Krishna away from us. And Krishna is our life and soul. How can we live without Krishna? So, Akrura was not famous among Brajabasis. If Akrura had to stand in election, Akrura will miserably fail. he was not popular at all among the Brajabasis. But Akrura is also doing his service. And Krishna knows that Akrura has come. He is doing his service and it's a favor for Krishna. It's a favor for everybody. Right? We discussed that part. So now, how everybody agreed, how Akrura traveled back from Vrindavan to Mathura, how was this travel? On the way, they stopped at Yamuna. Akrura wanted to offer prayers standing in the waters of Yamuna. And it's a culture, it's a system. When you go to some holy river, you should take bath or sprinkle some water from the holy river, offer, chant some mantras there. So Akrura wanted to go in the waters of Yamuna and take shower, take bath and offer his Gayatri. And what he saw there in the waters of Yamuna, and finally entrance into Mathura. So that we'll discuss next time. I may fast forward and I may directly jump into entrance into Mathura. We need to finish this series in the next session. Up to killing of Kamsa. Gantra Shrimad Bhagavatam ki
jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda ki
jai.
Thank you very much. Anybody has any questions, comments? Any questions, comments? No question? Yes, Nilesh, go ahead.
If like Krishna is like Trikalpana, right? So he already knew that my friend Sudama is poor and everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why did he help him before? Like, well, he already knew that he is staying here and everything, right? For example, if two school buddies are there, right? And they, usually they keep like, right? So why didn't he help him earlier and why? Is it just part of a
Leela
or something?
No, it is part of Leela, but the main point to understand is Krishna, he does not interfere with our free will, and Krishna does not interfere with our shelters towards Krishna. Krishna is waiting and watching. Are we ready to come to Krishna? Or we are ready, or we are just waiting and staying away from Krishna. So Sudama had been staying away from Krishna. He is remembering Krishna, but he is not ready to go. He is not ready to go to Krishna. And Krishna is waiting. When Sudama will come to me? When Sudama will come to me? So Krishna is like a dear friend. So the Krishna is with everybody. Krishna is with all of us also. Krishna is in everybody's heart as Paramatma. And as a Paramatma sitting in the heart, he is a witness. In the world also, we see people are suffering. And that is the common question come. If God is there, why God does not help? Why God does not solve the problem? Because he does not interfere with our free will. He is witnessing and watching for us to turn towards him. We are trying to enjoy in this world. We are trying to stay away from Krishna, trying to handle the things on our own. But as soon as we turn towards Krishna, then Krishna guides. Then Krishna provides his knowledge. Krishna provides all his help in various ways. So that is also same way. Krishna knows Sudama's situation. Krishna knows everybody's situation. But Krishna is waiting for Sudama to come to him.
So it's like, let's say, two school friends are there, right? One friend is still in India and he is suffering, and the other friend is in US, right? the third friend, he informs the US friend about that friend, oh, he's poor and he's in bad situation. This guy immediately helps him without even waiting for that India guy to come
so
to contact.
So that is again your way of thinking, but the other person may also think that way, that I do not want to hurt the self-esteem of other person. Somebody may be poor, it doesn't mean he is unhappy or he is dissatisfied. I may think from my point of view, oh, he does not have as much money as I have. Let me transfer $10,000 in his account. But are you sure that person will like that? He may think that you have hurt his self-esteem. Isn't it? Because no matter in what situation you are, everybody has their self-esteem. That, oh, I want to do this on my own. If I have a need, then I will come to you. You can tell your friend, please let me know if you need anything from me. And he may say, yes, I will let you know when I need something. But before he lets you know, just out of your own pride, out of your own ego, to fulfill your own ego, you say, oh, let me give these things to him. So it may also not be a gesture of kindness, it is gesture of your own pride.
So to add to that question, Prabhuji, is that something to do with the karma, that one has to go through their own karma and fulfill what they need to?
Yes, whatever problem comes in our lives, that is because of karma, right? Karma is controlling everything. Because of karma, what we gain in life as good or bad, it's because of karma. But when we take shelter of Krishna, Krishna can nullify that karma. But till that point, Krishna is going through, everybody is going through that process of karma. Krishna has made that what you call as law of karma. And everybody has to go through that natural law of karma. But if somebody takes shelter of Krishna, what does Krishna say? In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna speaks very wonderfully actually. Sarvadharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshishyami mashucha. I will relieve you from all the sinful reaction. Do not worry. So Krishna says, just surrender unto me. Right? Come to me. Ek bar hum apne muh se jab Bhagwan ko bolte hain, abhi main tumhara hoon. Then Krishna take charge. Usse pehle hum kya bol rahe hain? I will handle everything on my own. Right? Don't interfere. So when we take shelter of Krishna, Krishna can remove all that reaction. That's how I, from Akrura's prayer, number 2 and number 3, what we should learn, I am so fortunate. And I am so fallen, I am so sinful. It is just mercy of Krishna. Right? When we suffer with little bit small problem, we think, oh, based on my sinful reaction, I may have gone into big trouble. But it is just because of mercy of Krishna that Krishna has given me little token only. Right? When you get a cut on the finger, one should think, because of my karmic reaction, maybe my whole hand may have cut. But Krishna gave me only small token and Krishna saved me. Chota se cut laga ungal pe. Right? When your finger get burnt little bit. Yeah, maybe I could have burnt in fire. It is just token of Krishna, mercy of Krishna. Krishna saved me just with a small token. Krishna relieved me from all the big problem. So when we engage in bhakti, when we understand Krishna, then this mood develops. Right? Taking more and more shelter of Krishna, considering everything as mercy of Krishna. Either it's a problem in life or it's some benefit, benediction you get in life. Both are as a mercy. Krishna holds 4 things, right? Lord Vishnu holds 4 things in his hands. What are those 4 things?
Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma.
So now 4 things, these 4 things, 2 things are for devotees, 2 things are for demons. So chakra and gada is to punish, right? So those 2 things are for demonic people. Shankh and padma, they are for devotees. Through the shankh is sign of auspiciousness. When you blow the conch shell, The sound, it represents auspiciousness, right? It drives all negative energy away. And Padma, Padma is what? Sign of peace, beauty. And Gada and Chakra is to kill, to destroy. So either Krishna showers mercy on devotees or he punishes demons. Both are Krishna's mercy only. In both ways, Krishna is delivering them. चाहे वो भक्तों का उद्धार कर रहे हैं चाहे वो असुरों का उद्धार कर रहे हैं पर दोनों का उद्धार ही है. सो ही इज बीइंग काइंड टू बोथ डिलीवरिंग बोथ. सो वी शुड फील इन दैट वे आइदर प्रॉब्लम कम इन लाइफ और सम बेनिफिट केम इन लाइफ बोथ आर कृष्णा मर्सी ओनली. कृष्णा गेव मी द प्रॉब्लम सो आई कैन बिकम लिटिल रिनाउंस्ड फ्रॉम दिस वर्ल्ड राइट. आई कैन सरेंडर मोर टू कृष्णा टेक मोर शेल्टर ऑफ कृष्णा. Okay, any other question?
So one more question. Like Hiranyakashipu, Ravana, and all of they opposed the Rama, Vishnu, or Ram, and they killed by Rama and Krishna, and they went to the Vaikuntha.
Hmm.
Like we now we oppose and we can kill by. Is it possible in this Kali Yuga? Like killed by Krishna, right?
Hmm. So you
I
think
is it possible in this Kali Yuga, like
is there way?
Yeah, that's a good question, right?
Yeah.
So if somebody feels that way, Ravana, Kamsa, they got the benediction of being killed by personally by Lord Zen,
yeah.
And they went back there. What is my scope? Do I have to wait for Krishna's next appearance? What is our scope? So actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what he says is he came to deliver all the people, not by killing them with his Sudarshana, but delivering them by Harinam. So we should not wait for Krishna to personally come and chop our head with his Sudarshana or beat up with his Gada. We should take to the holy name. And holy name is for deliverance of all the mankind. Not just humans, all species of life, we can get delivered. When Nityananda was attacked by Jagai and Madhai, you have heard that pastime? So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela, right? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he came for the purpose of spreading the holy name, to distribute the love of Godhead. And he will send his devotees, Nityananda, Haridas Thakur and others, to go out and engage others in chanting the holy name. Kaho Krishna, bolo Krishna, karo Krishna siksha. So they will go door to door, knock on their door. And as people will open the door, they will see there is nobody. Then they will see on the floor and they are just paying saksha dandvat pranam. And they will say, please, once say name of Krishna. So they are asking everybody, chant the holy name. And once they met this two very wretched people, Jagai and Madhai, by birth they were Brahmanas, but they took to all the wrong ways. So they have become drunkard, they are eating all sort of nonsense things, they are messing with everybody, they are torturing women. So they came in front of Jagai Madhai and Nityananda told, chant the name of Krishna. And they were in a drunkard stage and they threw that pot, liquor pot, on the head of Nityananda and it started bleeding. And the news went to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came running. Who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? He is Krishna. He came in the form of his own devotee to teach the world how to become a devotee. Radha Krishna, nahi anya. So, Jai Gaur Sai Krishna. He is same as Krishna. He is himself Krishna. Now, Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, immediately he called to Sudarshana, 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 and he came running with Sudarshana to kill Jagai Madhai. And Nityananda stopped him. Please forgive them, please do not kill them. If you kill, you have to kill everybody in this world. In Kali Yuga, everybody is like that. Everybody is so fallen, everybody is so sinful. So you have not come to lift Sudarshana in this world, you have to come to deliver everybody by the chanting of the holy name. So Mahaprabhu has given this special mercy in Kali Yuga, spreading the holy name, because Krishna has manifested in Kali Yuga in the form of holy name. Kali Kale नाम रूपे कृष्ण अवतार. सो इफ यू आर वेटिंग फॉर कृष्ण टू कम एंड किल यू, कृष्ण हैज कम इन द फॉर्म ऑफ होली नेम. किल योर सेल्फ बाय चैंटिंग द होली नेम. सो एंगेज इन चैंटिंग द होली नेम. In that way, it will remove all the impurities from heart and it will make us to go back to Krishna in the spiritual world, in Vaikuntha. Why you want to be killed by the hands of Krishna and go to Vaikuntha? You can chant the holy name and go to Vaikuntha. There are so many pastimes, so many stories signifying the importance of the holy name. So we have done so many classes just on the glories of holy name, right? Importance of chanting. We should make a habit to hear those repeatedly. Every few weeks, every month, maybe once again hear that one. So we keep ourselves absorbed in that. We don't forget that.
Akrura was a minister.
Akrura was a minister.
So did he drive himself to chariot or the chariot?
Yes, no. Akrura came himself. He came as a driver to take Krishna and Balram.
Because
he's
a minister, of course. Minister, you have some
kind of safety. Yes. He doesn't want to sit in the back seat and use the chariot.
Yeah.
This chariot is an offering to Krishna. So this chariot is a bhoga for Krishna, not as a prasad for Krishna.
And also...